In the city of Moulton, crime is at an all-time high, with murder, robbery and corruption ruling the streets, with the public demanding results in an end to crime. A task force was created to combat these vile criminal elements as they continue to plague this city. The squad was led by me, Lieutenant Jim Reed, though most people here call me Noir Reed. And in this series of the Noir Files, we look at the most infamous and most ruthless hitman for hire, who was called into Moulton City to kill all members and associates of the Crime Busters, so that the Duke can now have complete control of the city. His name was Kang Lafang, aka the Samurai. Origins of this man are really unknown. According to FBI reports, Kang was born in a small village in Shanghai. As a young boy, he loved the world of the samurai. The codes, honor, discipline intrigued the young man, and he trained himself to be a highly skilled warrior. And it's believed that he was been responsible for many killings, all of whom were gangsters, either in the triads, the yakuzas, or hell, even the Tongs. He eventually migrated to the US and became a hitman for hire. The prize was $1 million a contract. He was so efficient and quick, his victims were usually connected to organized crime or those who opposed it. Now, when the Duke contacted him, he offered him $15 million for all the Crime Busters' heads. He agreed, as there was no way he was going to ignore that money. And as for the Duke, well, he was in some trouble right now. As Seth Eugene had a public announcing that he was going after the crime lord, the Duke, and as a result, the Duke's real name, Solomon Fudge, was pretty much in the newspapers. You know, but he was claiming that, you know, I'm not a gangster, I'm just a businessman, and I'm part of a very well-aristocratic family that has no connections to organized crime. However, any investigations that Seth was into, that was turning little up to nothing because of, again, the MCUPD were pretty much on his payroll. So he got internal affairs to investigate him. If that wasn't enough, the Duke was also sensing a rebellion amongst the crime gangs he was in control of, and the media headlines were making him appear weaker. However, if he got rid of the Crime Busters, he could gain control of the city's underworld. Plus, Ziva was about to retake office, since she was acquitted of her previous charges, so he needed to act fast in order to regain control of the city immediately. Now, just before the day the samurai came into town, every one of the crime busters were going about their normal everyday activities. Me, Ziva were having a dinner date, Brett, Abby, Jessica, and Seth were at an arcade place having a good time. Olivia, Leroy, Joan, and Dark Wall training new recruits that were now a part of the Crime Busters as the team was slowly coming back together, like being reinstated into the police department courtesy of the trials. And it would have been just quiet until I got a mysterious text from an individual who I still did not yet know who it was, and basically saying, men, you know, that people were coming. Suddenly, men bursted at all the locations and a gunfire erupted.
When I move, get more than this, I do, and just ignore, okay? family, Dad?
No, but they're down.
Wake up in a couple hours, your head's gonna be throbbing. You're gonna regret not talking. Oh, you were just the bait.
Go, go, go!
All the men were taken down. However, Leroy was shot. He died on his way to hospital. I managed to interrogate one of the men still alive, but he practically gave us very little information. The only thing I got out of him was that our days were numbered. Ziva managed to interrogate him, and he gave up that there's a hitman in town to kill us all, named the Samurai. We returned to my neighborhood bar, where Abby was there, trying to track down who sent the text message came from, but she couldn't. It was untraceable. We also looked up the Samurai, and we got to know a little bit more about him. Realizing that we needed some muscles, I made a call. And guess who I called? The Masked Dragon. I asked if she could come into town. She agreed and came driving straight in. Now, Abby took a look at all the shooting locations and found that there were surveillance cameras, along with a homing beacon that exposed our locations, and also filmed us. I guess the Samurai wanted to see us, what we were like in action. I asked Terra, Ziva, to get the kids out of here as quickly as they can, so the Samurai couldn't target them. I was wrong. As they were driving away, they were ambushed by the Samurai.
Get this under control now!
He kidnapped them and took them hostage. At the crime scene, when we came to investigate, I came and met for the first time Internal Affairs Captain Craig Munch. He was there investigating the scene and happened to be an old friend of mine. He showed us a clip of, you know, found on essentially on one of the dead hoods. It was a video from the Samurai with a demand that all the crime busters are to meet at an old abandoned warehouse or he start killing hostages. We complied, but Detective Munch wanted to join us. As the crime busters entered through the warehouse, the Masked Dragon went through the back to release the hostages.
Thank you.
The Mazdragon managed to rescue the kids, however, she couldn't find Ziva and Joan. On their way out, Brett noticed a computer and looked through the data. Abby realized it was all the criminals and politicians on the payroll of the Duke, however, none from the police. She then began to download the information to reveal to the people, reveal the information of the people taking bribes, and the crew quickly made their escape. Now, by the time the crime busters entered through the building, the Duke was there, along with Elliot Malone and the Samurai, along with a squad of goons holding the two ladies hostage. Just as he ordered us to stand down, a mysterious figure then dropped a canister of gas on the floor, and smoke came out. Samurai took Ziva and ran for it, while a gun battle quickly ensued. After the gunfight, I quickly made a run for it to catch up with the samurai who took Ziva. All the thugs were essentially either killed or knocked out, and they managed to rescue Joan. When I caught up with Ziva, the samurai took out his sword and said that he had a contract and must honor it. He sliced her head off. I was enraged and ran after him. I picked up a pipe and began to duel. I picked up his sword and began thinking of cutting his head off, but then Mudge happened to step in and said that I was an honest cop and I wouldn't be able to live with myself if I went through with it. I agreed and dropped the sword. The samurai was finished. I thanked the Master Dragon for all her help, and said if she needed anything, she could contact me. I asked her how she managed to drop the canister in time, but she said she didn't drop it. By that point, I began to suspect there was someone behind all these events. I told the squad about Ziva's death, and they all took it really hard. We held a funeral for her, and many came to pay their respects, but it hurted me, Brett, Abby, and Seth the most. However, the death was not in vain, as the files we got gave internal affairs enough evidence to arrest everyone on the Duke's payroll. The only people that were we couldn't arrest was the mayor, the police, and especially Elliot Malone. As a result of that, all crime organizations from the ball to the other mobs essentially turned against the Duke, defecting. Essentially, the Duke had really lost control of most of the underworld. As a result, he was forced to go underground. This drove him to the point of desperate to regain control of the city. As a result, he called in a favor to have a terrorist group come in and be his new muscle. And you want to find more about that? Join us in our next video. But for now, another criminal is locked up, and I, Noir Reed, call this case closed. So join us next time as we tackle another criminal in the Noir Files. See you then.